Hi, I'm Eric Siegel with ericstrains.com, and today we're going to be taking a look at a beautiful new 3-rail O-scale engine, the Lion-L Vision Line Baldwin Centipede. Lion-L first cataloged the Vision Centipede in 2011, and then it was delivered in late August of 2012. It is a Vision Line product, and the Vision Line is Lion-L's top-tier product line. It's the best of the best, and it's often used as a testbed for some of the most cutting-edge technologies and features on the market. And without fail, in my opinion, all of the Vision Line offerings have been outstanding, and the Centipede is certainly no exception. The Centipede was a rather obscure diesel. It was not very successful in its day, and for that reason, not many of them were made. So it was an interesting choice for Lion-L to make a Vision Line rendition of the Centipede. I know that some people out there would rather that Lion-L do more mainstream offerings for the Vision Line, like maybe a Big Boy or a J, or something more popular like that. And I can't argue with that, it would certainly be nice, but at the same time, I think that doing obscure engines like the Centipede is part of what the Vision Line is all about. As I said, the Vision Line is all about cutting-edge technology and features, but it's also about going where no one has gone before. And while they have done some mainstream Vision offerings like the Challenger and so forth, I think it's cool that this time around, instead of doing something that's been done many, many times in the hobby, they decided to go in a different direction and do something a little more offbeat like the Centipede. The real Centipede was a massive 12-axle diesel that was manufactured by Baldwin between 1945 and 1948. They only manufactured about 55 of these, so as I said, it was not a very successful diesel. And the main reason for that in general was because Baldwin was just not very good at making diesels. They made great steam engines back in the steam era, but when diesel power started to come into prominence, Baldwin was very slow and reluctant to adopt diesel technology, and so for that reason they were never able to catch up. They built their diesel engines just like they built their steam engines. They were all one of a kind, no two were exactly alike, and they used a lot of steam era technology in their diesels, and so all of this combined to make their engines a pain in the butt to run and maintain, and so for that reason, they were never able to compete in the diesel marketplace, and that's why eventually Baldwin went out of business. But what's great about our hobby is that you can take an engine that wasn't so successful in real life and turn it into a great model, and that's exactly what Lion-L has done here with the Vision Centipede. Now, as far as the Lion-L model goes, many of you will note that Union Pacific never actually had any Centipedes in its fleet. And that's true, but this is not entirely a fantasy paint scheme. It does have a basis in reality. The story is that UP actually did order a set of Centipedes from Baldwin, and those were to be numbered 998 and 999 like you see here. However, UP canceled that order before the engines were ever delivered, and so those engines ended up eventually being scrapped. So this is sort of like a what-if paint scheme, sort of like the UP Centipedes that almost were, but never quite came to pass. So even though this particular paint scheme is not very prototypical, I personally decided to get it because it had an interesting story behind it, and because I just like the UP paint scheme. But for those of you who are looking for something a little more realistic, don't worry, because Lion-L made three other versions of the Centipede. There are two Pensy versions, a 5-stripe and a single stripe, and there's also a blue Baldwin demonstrator paint scheme. Now, keep in mind that no matter which version of the Centipede you decide to get, they are all pretty much identical except for a few minor differences. One of the differences is because this is a Vision Line engine, the cab chatter will differ slightly between the different road names. And then also on the roof of the Pennsylvania Centipedes, you will find the trademark Pennsylvania radio antenna. So let's start the review of Lion-L Centipede by going over some facts and figures for this model. This set is a monster both in length and weight. The length of each unit is about 23 inches, and from coupler to coupler, the entire set is about 47 inches long. So that's almost 4 feet of O-scale goodness coming down the rails. This set is extremely heavy owing to its die-cast metal construction. The front unit weighs in at 9 pounds 10 ounces. The back unit is actually a little heavier and weighs in at an even 10 pounds. So altogether, you've got a whopping 19 pounds and 10 ounces. The minimum recommended curve on this engine is 072, and I'm going to stick with Lion-L's recommendation on this. I've tried running this on 063, and the overhang was just ridiculous. So if you want this engine to be happy, you need to stick with 072 or larger. The drive system on the Centipede is incredible. On each unit, you've got two flywheel motors, 12 axles or 24 wheels. 8 axles are driven, so you've got 16 drive wheels and 8 traction tires. So between both units, you've got a total of 4 motors, 24 axles or 48 wheels, 16 drive axles or 32 drive wheels, and 16 traction tires. It's amazing. The sheer weight of this engine, plus all of those motors, drive wheels, and traction tires, give this thing some outstanding pulling power. Each unit has a little over 4 pounds of pulling power, so altogether, you've got over 8 pounds of pulling power. And to put that in perspective, most Lionel post-war engines had maybe a pound or so of pulling power at best. Most modern O-scale diesels have anywhere between 1.5 and 3 pounds of pulling power, give or take. And this thing has over 8 pounds of pulling power. So what that translates to for most of us is that you can pull pretty much anything you want behind this engine. Now let's take a few minutes to talk about the sound and control systems on the Vision Centipede, starting with the control system. Each of these two units feature Lionel's legacy control system, and each unit comes with its own legacy module. You get one module for the lead 998 unit, and then you get a second module for the 999 unit back here. What that means is that each of these units is its own independent engine. So if you want to, you can run these two engines independently of each other. You don't have to run them together if you don't want to. But of course, the two units are intended to be run together, and that's how I would recommend running them. When you do run them together, you don't have to use both legacy modules. What you do is you use the legacy module from the lead 998 unit, and then you assign both units with the same ID, and then they will both operate together as one big engine. But it's nice to have that extra flexibility of the secondary legacy module for the 999 unit, so that if you want to, you can run this 999 as its own independent engine somewhere else on your layout. Now let's talk about the sound effects on the Centipede. Each of the two units is equipped with its own legacy rail sounds module and two speakers that do a wonderful job delivering that great full bassy sound that Lionel is known for. So altogether, you've got two independent sound systems and four speakers. Now, not only does each engine have its own separate sound system, but the sound set on each engine is specifically geared for the function of that engine within the entire set. So the sound set on the front engine is a sound set that's appropriate for the front engine on the train. And then the sound set on the trailing unit is a sound set that's appropriate for a trailing engine on a train. So on the lead unit, the prominent sounds are going to be the prime mover, of course, and then the crew talk, the horn, and the bell. On the trailing unit, the prominent sound is going to be the prime mover, but the crew talk sounds are absent, and the sounds of the horn and the bell are significantly diminished. Now, at first, you may think that's a bad thing. You may say to yourself, hey, Lionel went cheap and didn't put a full sound set back here in the second unit. But that's not the case. What they've done is actually something that, to my knowledge, has never been done before. There is a full sound set back here, but instead of being a standalone sound set, it's a sound set that is specifically intended to complement the sounds of the front unit and enhance the sound of the entire set. The most noticeable example of this occurs when you blow the horn. When the horn is activated, most of the horn sounds come from the front unit, as they should. But then in the rear unit, what you get is this sort of ghost-like after-effect sound of the horn, and it's such that if you heard it by itself, it would sound kind of weird, but when you hear it in concert with the front unit, it produces this incredible reverberation effect where the sound of the horn sort of ripples down the entire set, and the overall result is phenomenal. There's really no easy way to describe this sound. You have to hear it to understand it. So if it doesn't make sense yet, don't worry, because in a few minutes I'll start the engine up and play the sounds, and hopefully at that point you'll have a better understanding of what I'm talking about. But I think Lionel really deserves a lot of credit here. This is something that I've never heard before, and to get back to what I'm always saying about the Vision Line is all about doing things that have never been done before, and this certainly falls into that category, and it's one of the reasons why the sound effects are one of the best features on the Centipede. Anyway, now that we've talked about the sound and control systems on the Centipede, let's move on to some other features. I've mentioned a couple times how heavy these engines are, and that's because they feature all metal construction. So the pilots, the trucks, the frames, and the shells are all made of metal. Pretty much the only things on this set that are not made of metal are the things that shouldn't be made of metal, like the windshields, the windshield wipers, the headlights, the diaphragms between the two units, and the fan housings up top are also made of plastic. But other than that, everything else is made of metal, most of it being die-cast metal, which is very heavy, and that's why this set has that great weight of almost 20 pounds, and that's a big factor into why this set has the great pulling power that it does. This is the third die-cast diesel that Lionel has produced in the last few years. The other two were also VisionLine engines, those being the VisionLine Genset Switcher and the VisionLine ES44 Hybrid. And I'm a big fan of the die-cast diesels. I know some people have mixed feelings about them because it does raise the price and therefore makes them less affordable. But I think it's worth it because the added heft and weight just makes these things so much more realistic when you touch them and hold them in your hand. So I think it's worth the extra price. That's not to say I don't like plastic body diesels. I certainly do. But I think there's room for both. You can have the more affordable plastic body diesels, and then you can have a few high-end die-cast diesels. So I hope that Lionel will continue to make more die-cast diesels in the future. The last two features that I want to talk about before we look at the details on this set are the smoke units and the roof fans. Each unit comes equipped with two operational smoke units, one at the front and one at the back. So altogether, you've got four operating smoke units on this set. That puts out an awful lot of smoke, and it looks really cool. And then on the top of each unit, you've got the controversial roof fans. There are four operational fans on the top of each unit, and those fans spin at all times when the engine is in operation. They're really cool, but as I said, they have been the source of some controversy. I'll go into more specifics about that when we take a detailed look at the fans in a few minutes. So let's go ahead and start to look at the details of this set. Here's a look at the Pilot, and when you first look at the Pilot, you may get the impression that Lionel did not do a good job, because there's not a whole lot of action going on down here. But actually, that is very true to the prototype. If you look at any pictures of the centipedes, you'll notice that the Pilot was very barren. It didn't have a whole lot going on. In fact, the only interesting thing that the Pilots really had were these holes right here. And Lionel has put those holes here and on the other side. So even though there's not a whole lot going on with the Pilot, Lionel actually did a very good job, and it's very true to the prototype. Something else you may notice is that the Pilot is not connected to the body of the engine. And at first, you may think that that's just typical three-rail O-scale, because most three-rail O-scale engines have a Pilot that's connected to the truck and not to the body, and that allows the Pilot to turn with the truck, and therefore allows the engine to negotiate the tighter turns that are typically associated with O-gauge layouts. But in this case, this is actually realistic, because on the real centipede, the Pilot was connected to the drivetrain down here and not to the body. So Lionel actually did a good job here, and this is actually very realistic. Now, of course, to allow this engine to negotiate tighter turns, they did articulate the Pilot off of the front truck a little bit. But as far as what you can see when you look at the engine like this, it's very realistic looking. You may also notice that on some models of the centipede, the Pilot may hang down just a little bit like that. Now on mine, it's up there pretty tight, but when you get one, you may find it's like that. Again, that's nothing to worry about, because if you look at pictures of the actual centipedes, they actually had a considerable gap between the Pilot and the body, so something like that is really nothing to worry about, and it's actually quite realistic. Just about the only thing that's not very realistic on the Pilot is the big O-gauge coupler, and of course, that can't be helped on a three-rail O-scale model. Now, this is an electrocoupler, so that means that you can fire it from the Legacy or TMCC remote. The front of the engine is very nicely done. The cab has that famous baby face look that the centipedes were famous for. Up on the front, we've got a nicely done UP logo and two separately applied grab irons. We've got operating marker lights as well as lighted number boards on either side, and then a nice headlight right there. The windshield wipers are separately applied, and they did a nice job on the windshields. And then in the cab, we've got two hand-painted crew figures as well as a very detailed cab interior. The trucks on the underside of each unit are painted a nice silver color, and as you can see, they're very well done with lots of nice detailing. Here on the side, we've got the windows for the cab, but the windows do not open or close. I would have liked to have seen windows that open and close on this model, but for whatever reason, they chose not to do it. It's one of those little things that I always look for, but it's really not that big of a deal. Down here, we've got a legible builder's plate, and there's another one on the other side of the cab. And then also, on either side of the cab, we've got doors like this one. This has separately applied metal grab irons on either side, a clear plastic insert in the window, and the door opens and closes like that. And it is sprung, so it'll snap back shut like that. And then back here, we've got these metal screens. They are not see-through, but they are made of metal. In the middle of the engine, we've got our nice UP logo, and then some separately applied detailing here and here, and then a big metal screen up here, and then some nice cast-in vent detailing up here. Toward the back of each engine, we've got another door, and there's a door just like it on the other side, and just like the doors up front, it opens and closes, has a clear plastic insert in the window, and has separately applied metal grab irons. And then we've got another nice metal screen right here. Here's a look at the space between the two engines. Down here, we've got some nice MU hose detail. And then between the two engines, we've got two dummy couplers. And these are not operating couplers, but dummy couplers. The only operating couplers are on either end of the set, but these two are dummy couplers. The reason for that is because it's not really recommended that you run these two engines apart. Now, as I said earlier, it is possible to run them apart from each other, but it's really not recommended. And the reason is because in real life, these Centipedes were very rarely run apart from each other. In fact, in most cases, they were semi-permanently coupled together, and so there's really no reason to have operating couplers right here at all. Also between the two engines are these soft rubber diaphragms. Now, the set comes with two different sets of diaphragms. The first set is what you're looking at now. This is the thicker set, and because they're thicker, the gap between the two diaphragms is smaller. Therefore, you get a more realistic look when you're running the engine. But if you're going to run the engine on curves that are on the smaller side, like 072, you may find that when you run the engine around a curve, these two diaphragms touch each other and will catch on each other. In that case, Lionel packages a second set of diaphragms, and those diaphragms are a little bit thinner, and therefore the gap between the two diaphragms is larger, and so you can run it around those tighter curves without a chance of the diaphragms touching or catching on each other. Here's a look at the back of one of the engines, and you can get a better look at the MU hose detail and the dummy coupler down here. And then we've got some nice separately applied detailing all around here, and some nice rivet detail. And then, of course, we've got an opening door right here with a nice clear plastic window. So altogether, you've got five opening doors on each engine, two on each side and one on the back. Up on top of each engine, we've got a nice separately applied metal horn right here. And then behind that, we've got this panel with these separately applied lift rings on it. Now, altogether, each engine has 16 of these separately applied lift rings up on top. If we remove the panel, it reveals a compartment where the optional 9-volt battery can be installed. Now, for those of you who are new to this, you may be wondering what the optional 9-volt battery is all about, so let me take a second and explain. You may find that when you run your engine on your layout that there are dead spots in the track, either because the track is dirty or maybe you've got a weird switch configuration where there's a dead spot, and when the engine rolls over that dead spot, the sound system on the engine may cut out. In that event, you can install a 9-volt battery in the engine so that the sound system will keep running even if the engine goes over a bad spot and you won't get any interruption in the sounds. It's completely optional. You don't have to install the 9-volt battery for the engine to operate. I don't ever install them because I just don't like the idea of having a bunch of batteries that could corrode inside all of my Lionel engines, and I've never really had a need for it. But if you find that you're having the sound system cut out on your layout because of some sort of track problem, you do have the option of putting that 9-volt battery in there. The panel itself does have magnets built into it so that when you put the panel back onto the engine, it will stay in place and it won't rattle around or come loose or anything like that. Behind the battery compartment, we've got a smokestack that contains the first of two operating smoke units that each engine has. And to load smoke fluid into the smoke unit, you simply pour the smoke fluid directly down the stack. And by the way, a lot of you have asked me where I get these needlepoint smoke fluid dispensers that I use in my videos. I get these from JT's Megasteam. You can find them online at www.megasteam.com. Back behind the smokestack, we've got this piece right here. This is the antenna that allows the engine to receive signals from the legacy command system. Now, ordinarily on a plastic body diesel, the antenna would be hidden inside the shell of the diesel and out of sight. And they can do that because the plastic shell won't interfere with the antenna getting a good signal from the legacy system. But on a metal body diesel, just like on a metal steam engine, you have to have the antenna on the outside of the engine, and it needs to be insulated from the rest of the metal body. And that's what they've done right here, and they've camouflaged it nicely with this little panel. Now, you'll notice that the panel does lift up a little bit and move like that. And at first, you may be tempted to lift the piece off of the engine altogether. But don't do that, because on this end, it's connected to the antenna wire. So if you pull it up too hard, you could break the antenna wire, and then the engine won't work correctly. In fact, it's probably best to leave this piece alone altogether, because if you start playing around with it, you could break the insulation on the wire or something like that, and then the engine will not work correctly. So know the antenna is right here, but other than that, leave it alone. Now we come to one of the best features of the Vision Line Centipede, and that, of course, is the set of operating fans on the top of each engine. Now, this is not the first Vision Line model to feature the operating fans. That honor goes to the Vision Line ES44 Hybrid that Lionel put out a few years ago. But this is sort of the next step in the evolution of this feature. The fans on this engine are a little more complex in their operation and therefore a little more prototypical. So let's go ahead and take a closer look and I'll explain. The cover on the fans is held down by magnets, so let's go ahead and pull it up. And as I said before, this is one of the few pieces on the engine that's actually made of plastic. And that reveals the fans. We've got four fans here, and the way these work is that whenever the engine is on, the fans spin. What changes is the speed at which the fans spin. When you first start the engine up, they spin at a slower speed, and then as you raise the RPMs, the speed of the fans increases, and then as you lower the RPMs back down, as the engine revs down, the fans slow down again. It's pretty cool. One of the best features of these operating fans is actually something that you can't see without taking the engine apart, and that is the motor that drives these fan blades. On the Lionel Vision Line ES44 hybrid diesel that they put out a few years ago, the rooftop fans were powered by a small miniature DC can motor. And there's nothing wrong with that, but what Lionel has done with the Centipede is they've taken that one step further and they've added a flywheel to that DC can motor, just like the flywheels that are on the motors that drive the engine itself. And for those of you who are new to the hobby, let me take a minute and explain what flywheels are all about. Manufacturers have been putting flywheels on the motors in the engines for years. What a flywheel is it's a heavy metal disc that rides on top of the motor, and it spins with the motor when the motor is in operation, and it builds up momentum, and that's why sometimes they're called momentum flywheels. And what it does is when power is cut to the motor, instead of the motor stopping abruptly, it allows the motor to slowly coast down to a nice smooth stop. And so by putting a flywheel on the motor that powers the fans, it does the same thing. When you start the engine up, you'll get a nice smooth start to the fan blades. And then when you shut the engine down, instead of the fan blades stopping abruptly, you'll get a nice smooth stop. And it looks very realistic. I think Lionel deserves a lot of credit here because they didn't have to do this. They could have left those flywheels off and most people probably wouldn't have noticed. But I think it says a lot that they actually went the extra step and added the flywheel because it's subtle, but it really does make a difference and adds a lot of realism to the operation of the fans. Another neat aspect of these operating fans is the lighting. And at this point, you may be saying, hey, Eric, what are you talking about lighting? How can fans be lighted? Well, on either side, they've got an LED, and then each LED is connected to a clear plastic lighting tube. And the result is that this entire area is illuminated, so that when the cover is back on, you can still see the fan spinning because the whole area is illuminated. And it's especially effective if you're in a room where the lights have been dimmed a little bit, because even in dim lighting, you can still look over and those lights allow you to see the fans operating. And again, I think Lionel deserves a lot of credit here. This is something that they did not have to do. Nobody would have missed the lights if they weren't there. So I think it really says a lot that they went that extra step to add those lights just to showcase the operating fans. The operating fans are definitely one of the best features of the Centipede, and when I start the engine up in just a few minutes, I'll show you everything I just talked about, and then you'll have a better idea of how they actually work. Now, as cool and innovative as the operating fans are, as I said earlier, they have been the source of some controversy. Most of that controversy has centered around the level of noise that the fans produce when they're operating. Some people have complained that the noise is so great that you can hear it over the sounds of the engine. Now, my personal experience has been that I haven't had any problems with it. Yes, they do make some noise, but the sounds of the engine drown most of that noise out. So I personally haven't had an issue with it, but some people have. Now, Lionel has offered a couple fixes for this, including lubricating the gears and so forth. And other people have found success with tightening up the gears so they don't rattle around so much. And my own experience has been that the longer you run the engine, the quieter the fans will be. When I got the engine, when it was brand new, the fans were a little noisier than they are now. But now that I've run the engine 10 or 20 hours, those fans have quieted down quite a bit. But the fact is, you're not going to get whisper quiet operation out of these fans. It's just not going to happen. And the reason is because there's a lot of mechanical action going on here. You've got the motor itself, then you've got a bunch of gears, and then you've got the fan blades. So that's a lot of moving parts, a lot of mechanical action going on, so it's going to make some noise. Now, you shouldn't get an excessive amount of noise, but it's unreasonable to expect these things to be absolutely silent. Now, if you are one of those people who got a centipede where the fans are making what you consider to be an excessive amount of noise, my recommendation would be to contact Lionel Surface Department. This is a VisionLine product. You should get top-notch support, and hopefully they'll be able to help you work through any issues with the noise. Other than the noise issues that some people have had, my only criticism of the fans is that when the engine is on, there's no way to turn the fans off if you want. They run all the time, whether you want them to or not, and I think it would have been a nice thing if they had put a little switch somewhere to turn them off if you so desired. But it's not that big of a deal. It's nothing that would prevent me from buying the model again. I just think it would have been a nice feature to have. But it's something that I'm going to fix myself. What I'm planning on doing is taking this little switch that I bought from Miniatronics and installing it in line with the wires that power the fans, and then I'm going to mount the switch in the battery compartment right up under here. And that way I'll be able to turn the fans on and off as I choose. Now, ordinarily when I do these reviews, I try to stay away from a lot of personal opinion and personal philosophy, but lately it seems that whenever I go to an online forum, there's all sorts of negativity surrounding any problems that come up with these new advanced features, and so I wanted to take a minute and weigh in on this and sort of give my own perspective on the whole thing. First of all, as I've said before, the VisionLine is all about cutting-edge technology and features, and being on the cutting edge results in some great features, but when you live on the cutting edge, sometimes you're going to get cut. When you're working with features that have never been done before, it's inevitable that you're going to run into a few bugs along the way. That just goes with the territory. The VisionLine, in my opinion at least, is not about being safe and conservative, but rather it's about being innovative and living on that cutting edge, and so I think it's important to take that into consideration when these new features show up for the first time. Sometimes they're not going to work 100% correctly, and that's just life on the cutting edge. And you also have to consider that Lionel is not a huge company, and they don't have hundreds of people working in some big R&D department somewhere, so unfortunately, a lot of these bugs that crop up have to be worked out along the way after the product has been released. But I would rather have these great features and deal with a few bugs along the way than to never have them at all. Secondly, and more importantly, while I think everyone is entitled to their opinion, I think there's a danger in giving Lionel nothing but negative feedback when it comes to any hiccups that come along with these new features. Lionel's trying to make a profit, and these VisionLine engines are very expensive to manufacture. And if all they get is negative feedback, what incentive do they have to push forward and continue making these innovative products? If all they get is negative feedback, the danger is they may decide it's just more trouble than it's worth and stop making the VisionLine products altogether, or stop working on cool features like these operating fans. And if that were to happen, in my opinion, it would be a tragedy for the hobby. The last few years have been so exciting with so many new features coming out with the VisionLine. It's been great for the hobby, and if that were to go away, it would be a terrible loss for all of us. Personally, I think a better approach would be to, instead of giving negative feedback, give positive constructive criticism back to the manufacturers. So for example, when it comes to the problem of the fan noise, I would say something like, "Hey Lionel, I really like the operating fans. I think they're a fantastic innovation. Yes, there are a few bugs that need to be worked out, but I love these new features and I'm excited to see what you'll do next." I think an approach like that is much more constructive and productive than just a whole bunch of negative feedback. It lets the manufacturer know that yes, there are some bugs, but we support these innovations and we want more in the future. And I think if we, the customers, take a more positive approach like this, it can end up being win-win for both sides. Anyway, that's all I have to say about that. I'll get off my soapbox now and get back to the review. Moving back past the fans, we've got another panel, but unlike the panel up front, this one detaches completely to reveal the controls for the engine. You've got the run program switch, the Odyssey speed control on-off switch, and then the on-off switches for the two smoke units, as well as the master volume control. And the panel is held down by magnets, so when you put it back in place, it'll stay where you put it. And finally, back here, we've got the rear smokestack, which contains the second operating smoke unit, and just like the front one, to load it up, you just pour smoke fluid directly down the stack. Here's what the underside of each engine looks like, and as I said before, there's a lot of wheels going on here. 24 wheels per engine, 8 traction tires, 2 here, 2 here, 2 here, and 2 here. And then we've got 4 pickup rollers, and underneath all of this, we've got 2 speakers. Here's what the inside of each engine looks like with the shell removed. Here's a better look at the detailed cab interior, and while it's very detailed, they didn't paint a lot of the valves and gauges and so forth, and I suspect the reason they did that is because when the shell is on, it's very hard to see inside the cab, so there really wasn't any reason for it. But what I may do for a nice rainy day project is go in here and hand paint some of these valves and gauges just to get it a little more detailed than it already is. Right here you can see the two flywheel motors that drive the engine, and then in the middle of that is the sound enclosure for the sound system. And this is really the secret behind why Lionel has some of the best sounds in the industry. They've got two high quality speakers surrounded by this sealed plastic sound box, which helps to generate that great thundering bass and low end that Lionel is known for. Here's the inside of one of the die-cast shells. The two smoke units that each engine has are here and here. And then this is the roof fan system. And there's that miniature flywheel motor that I was talking about earlier. Here's a look at the rear unit of the set. Now, the rear unit is exactly the same as the front unit with just three differences. First of all, obviously, there's a different cab number, 999 instead of 998. Secondly, as I mentioned earlier, the rear unit does have a different sound set than the front unit. It's a sound set that's meant to complement the front unit rather than stand on its own. And then lastly, because this is the rear unit of the set, there are no people in the cab. And that's appropriate because there's no reason you would have people in the rear unit of a setup like this. Okay, the last thing we're going to do before we start this engine up is BFIMO, best feature in my opinion. In my opinion, the best feature of the Vision Lion Centipede is the sound system. The sounds on this set are phenomenal. They've got lots of bass. They're very full. They are very well balanced between the two engines. And as I said earlier, that echo effect with the horn between the two engines is absolutely amazing. I've never heard anything like it before, and that puts the sounds in a league of their own. And that's why, in my opinion, the best feature of the Centipede is the sound system. All right, now comes the fun part. Let's go ahead and crank this baby up and see what she's got. Now, the startup sequence is really nice. This thing will kind of rumble to life. It's really well done. So let's go ahead and do the startup sequence.
UP998, do you copy?
Union Pacific 998, copy that, over.
Okay, start her up, stand by for track orders.
UP998, starting up, out.
Now, with the engine just idling here, you're probably hearing a buzzing noise in the background. That noise is not the noise that I was talking about with the operating fans. What you're hearing is the noise of the fans that are powering the four smoke units on this set. There are four fans operating right now, blowing out smoke. So all those fans together are going to create a little bit of a buzz. It's no big deal, but I just wanted to point that out, that that's what you're probably hearing right now. The operating fans up on top are not making a lot of noise. Okay, first let's hear the horn, and because this is a modern, legacy-equipped Lionel engine, it's got that great quilling effect to the horn, so let's give it a listen. A couple times how great the horn effect is on this set, and what makes it so great is the reverberation effect that's in the rear unit. Now, I'm not sure how well you're going to be able to hear that effect on the video, but what I'm going to do is move the camera to a couple different positions and therefore move the microphone, and then I'll play the horn in those different positions, and hopefully that'll give you a better understanding of what I'm talking about. So first up, let's play the horn again from our present position, which is in front of the train. Now I've got the camera and the microphone facing the rear unit, so I'm going to go ahead and blow the horn again, and let's see what it sounds like from back here. Hopefully you'll be able to hear the reverb effect in the rear unit better. Let's give it a try. Thank you. Okay, now what I've done is I've turned the sounds on the front engine completely off. So the sounds you're hearing now are only coming from the rear unit. So I'm going to blow the horn again, and let's see what the horn sounds like when it's only coming from the rear unit. It's going to sound a little strange, but let's give it a try. You hear that? It's kind of like this ghostly echo of the horn. Now, it may sound a little weird by itself, but when you combine it with the full horn sound on the front engine, that's when it takes on that great echoey effect that makes the horn on this set so wonderful. So, with the sounds on the front engine turned on again, let's listen to the full horn effect one more time. Now let's give a listen to the bell. Now let's listen to some of the crew talk sequences. And I know that there are some people out there that don't like the crew talk. They think it's very unrealistic or kind of silly, but I like it. I think it's a lot of fun. And I can tell you that when I had the open house for my layout a couple months ago, I had a couple hundred visitors, and without a doubt, the number one thing that put a smile on the faces of kids and adults was when the trains started talking. They loved it, and I think that anything that gets kids and adults interested in the hobby is a good thing. And you know, if you don't like it, that's okay, just don't use it. Anyway, let's give it a listen.
998 is ready. Can we move to the main line? Over. Roger, your track is clear. Dispatcher, over. Roger that. UP-998 is cleared. Up. UP-998, take the green. Over. Okay. UP-998 is cleared. Up.
Okay, I've got the engine shut down now so that I can show you the operation of the fans from start to finish. So let's go ahead and take the cover off so you can see the fans. And now I'm going to start the engine up, and you'll see these things come to life. And then once the engine is going, I will raise the RPM level so that they will get faster. Then I'll lower the RPM levels back down, and they'll slow down. And then finally, we'll shut the engine back down, and you'll see these things coast to a stop. So let's go ahead and do it. And there they go, pretty cool. So now what I'm gonna do is raise the RPM levels, and you'll see the speed of the fans increase. And as I do, the noise of the fans will increase a little as well. That's unavoidable because, as I said earlier, there's a lot of mechanical action going on here. So let's go ahead and raise the RPMs. And as you can see, they get faster. Continue to raise the RPMs, they will get faster and faster until we're on the roof. RPM level now, and this is the fastest that you'll see the fans spin. As I said, they are a little noisier than they were when they started off, but that's unavoidable because of all that mechanical action. But to counteract that, the engine is also pretty loud at this point too. So now I'll lower the RPMs back down and the fan speed will decrease. Back to idle, and the fans are back to the speed at which they started. Pretty cool. I've dimmed the lights in the room to show you the other feature of the fans, which is the lights. And again, if I remove the cover from the fans, you can see those LED lights And with the cover back on, what it means is that even in a dimly lit room like this, I can look over and still see those fans spinning, which I think is really neat. And now I'm going to shut the engine down, and you'll see the fans coast to a nice smooth stop. And again, it's all thanks to that flywheel that Lionel added to the fan motor.
We're going to be 998 out.
Pretty cool. The last thing I want to do before running the Centipede around the layout for a couple minutes is to run the rear engine by itself independently of the front engine for just a minute, because I know a lot of you have asked whether or not this is possible, and earlier in the video I said, yes, it's possible, but I wouldn't really recommend it, so I want to show you what that's all about. Now, if you recall, I said that each unit has its own legacy module, so what I've done is I've taken the legacy module for this rear unit and assigned it a new ID in my legacy remote so that I can run it by itself. So let's go ahead and start it up. Okay, now, because normally this unit faces backward, it starts up in reverse, so if we want it to go forward, I have to reverse it, like that. So, now you'll see that I can go forward. I can go backwards. And we've got engine sound, so technically speaking, yes, you can run this independently of the front engine. But there are two problems here. The first one is that, as I said earlier, the horn on this rear unit is not a full horn sound, it's that echo sound. So when I blow the horn, this is what it sounds like. It's that ghostly echo of the horn, it's not a full horn, because this is meant to complement the front unit. The other problem is that there are no crew talk sounds and there's no bell sound either. So all you've got is engine sounds and a faint horn sound. Another problem is that, as you can see, there's no crew in this engine. And again, that's appropriate because ordinarily this would be facing backwards as the rear engine, and there would be no reason to have a crew up here. But what this means is that while you can run this independently, it would not be appropriate to run this engine at the head of a train. It's best as a helper engine. It would look weird running this thing at the front of a train because you've got no crew, you've got no horn, and you've got no bell. So, yes, you can run it at the front of a train, but I wouldn't do it. If you're going to run it independently, run it as a helper engine in a consist with other engines where you've got another engine that has full sounds and a crew at the head of the train. Okay, now I'm going to start this thing up one more time and run it around the layout for a few minutes.
UP-998, do you copy? Union Pacific 998, copy that, over. Very good, start up and hold. UP-998, starting up, out.
Okay, I'm going to activate sequence control by pressing and holding the AUX1 key on the legacy remote until I hear the ding ding toot sound, and that will put the engine into sequence control mode in which all the sounds will be automated.
Out.
Okay, that about wraps it up for this review. This is a fantastic engine that I'm thrilled to own, and I definitely think it's worthy of being a Vision Line product. Now, if you're interested in purchasing one of these sets, there are two obstacles you're going to have to overcome. The first obstacle is the price. These are very expensive. The retail price is $2,200. You heard correctly, $2,200. Now, if you go through a good Lion-L dealer, you should be able to get a discount off that and maybe get it for around $2,000. But even at that, it's still very expensive. Now, some people think that it's overpriced. I don't think so. I think it's right on par with other Vision Line engines. Consider that the Vision Line ES44 Hybrid was a $900 diesel, and the Centipede is more than twice as much engine as the ES44, plus it's got extra smoke units and extra fans and so forth. It's right where it should be, right around $2,000, so I don't think it's overpriced, but it's still very expensive. Now, if the $2,000 price tag is just too much for you, there's still hope, because in the 2012 Volume 2 Lion-L catalog, they've released what's called a half Centipede. It's basically just half of this set, just one unit. So instead of being $2,000, it's $1,000. And they did a few different road names, so check out the 2012 Volume 2 catalog if you're interested in one of the half Centipedes. I don't have one yet, but I'm guessing they're exactly the same as these. It's just one unit instead of two. The other obstacle you have to overcome is finding one of these sets. Lion-L shipped these back in late August of 2012. I'm making this video in January of 2013, so they've been out for a while now. I don't think Lion-L made a ton of these, so it may be hard to find one. That's not to say it's impossible. You just may have to look a while before you can find one. Now, if you don't have a good Lion-L train store of your own, try my favorite store, which is Legacy Station. They probably don't have any of these in stock now, but they may be able to locate one for you. Give them a call at 770-339-7780 or find them on the web at www.legacystation.com. Anyway, that's it for now. I'm Eric Siegel, and I'll see you next time.